Hello, my name is Veerle Haverals, and I work for the University of Antwerp, Belgium. This ILSA project video will give an overview on how to use the different platforms and programs to perform live subtitling for television. We continue to build on what you have learned in the previous modules, that is, the modules on subtitling, on simultaneous interpreting, and on inter- and intralingual speaking. There are different software systems for subtitling and live subtitling for television. At the moment, we know Swift, WinCaps Quantum, or QLive from Screen, Subtival, FAP, Subito of RedView Media, VeloTitle of P2P Media, and so on. But also more and more online platforms integrate the option of offering live subtitling in their software package. As Stuart Campbell is saying, who is a live text subtitling manager of Media Access Specialist ITFC on the website of CSI, the number of subtitled programs has grown year on year as a direct result of the Communications Act of 2003, which made it a legal requirement for television channels across all platforms to provide subtitling. Live broadcast subtitling is now used on a myriad of programs, from interviews and sporting events to news bulletins and live talk shows, and providers have to make sure the subtitles are as error-free as possible. Live broadcast subtitling traditionally involved a stenographer and was something of a dark art, both technically complex and expensive. It was also extremely hard to find skilled stenographers. But from 2000, the advent of voice recognition technology changed all that and opened up the market. Since then, the number of live broadcasts that are subtitled has increased exponentially. Voice recognition technology has made it cheaper to subtitle broadcast content. But it's vital to do as much initial preparation as possible. Liaising with clients is a key part of the preparation process, as it helps to develop the picture. Whether that's finding out about the details that might come up in the live feature, or, for news, receiving scripted links from the presenters. This helps to avoid continuous ad-libbing. There's also the preparation for the actual live content, the site that is simply unpredictable. There are a host of voice recognition packages on the market at the moment. At ITFC, we use Dragon Naturally Speaking 10. Each individual subtitler starts by setting up a new user account and building a voice profile within the software. The key is adapting the voice profile to match the user pronunciation of all the words. Although building a voice profile is important, it's more important to learn how to re-speak, an alternative to use the keyboard. This works by having program audio fed into the subtitler's headphones, allowing them to hear what's being said. The subtitler then re-speaks this into the microphone and voice recognition engine. The skills here is to balance listening to the rest of the conversation while noting the next important parts to re-speak. This is then transferred to the screen. Once a voice profile has been created, it has to be refined. This can be done by creating bespoke dictionaries for a number of different live broadcast content program types. For example, when creating a specific sports profile, we'd add all the footballers' names and places that we know may be used within the program. Doing this helps to make the job more manageable, keeps the profile smaller, and makes it a quicker, more efficient, and seamless process. The greatest challenge is that the current voice recognition software isn't specifically designed for subtitling, so getting the text into the program is essentially all it does. The software can store at least a paragraph's worth of text and then output it to where we need it, so we can get on air as soon as possible. Because of this, you have to speak in a very staccato way, as the software can store too many sentences and just spit them out too quickly onto the screen. Another major issue is when more than one presenter speaks at the same time. This can be difficult for the subtitler as they need to break up what's being said to re-speak it. At ITFC, we work on a magazine program called Live from Studio 5, and this situation can often occur. We overcome this by mentally editing and quickly deciding what's important to get across to the viewer, keeping sentences short and focusing on answers just as much as the question is often helpful. You also have to be more aware of what the guests on the show are saying in response to a question, as the emphasis is on them rather than on the presenter. It's a progression from the skills we used to use for live typing. When you type live, you obviously can't type as fast as people talk, so you end up editing in your mind, making sense of the story and noting the important parts. But you wouldn't always catch every single word. It's possible with voice recognition to get more subtitles onto the screen, but you don't necessarily want this to happen, as the reader needs a certain amount of time to view and take in what's on the screen. To do this, you still need to have the skills of deciding what the important parts to include are. Quality is important when you're subtitling a live broadcast. By its very nature, live subtitling is open to more mistakes. Before providers decided to make the move to voice recognition, it had to be proven to be equally as accurate. In general, voice recognition is 95% accurate, and at ITFC, we aim for 98% accuracy across broadcast subtitles. While Ofcom don't stipulate 100% coverage for live subtitles, provider must make sure they're achieving high quality levels. Many tend to have their own in-house guidelines designed to maintain standards. This is particularly important where service level agreements are in place with their clients, the broadcasters. Although it's important to get as much on the screen as possible, you still need to be accurate. Despite the limitations, voice recognition provides the perfect balance of both accuracy and volume, and we have been using it since 2002 when we started working on the ITV news channel. We start with the scripts and files we received in advance, and then supplement them with voice recognition to fill in the gaps. Many other facilities have been using voice recognition since 2000, and it's become the tool of choice. There's still plenty of room for further advance in subtitling. Voice recognition in technology has certainly made the process better, but the technology is not quite there yet to play the program audio straight onto the voice engine and have it to appear on screen. In my opinion, this is the next logical step. This process has been trailed on a couple of occasions at IBC and is still being worked on, but there's a long way to go. One of the biggest technical headaches is that the timbre of everyone's voice is very different. Pitches and levels all vary and you pronounce words differently. The speech recognition engine has to have a profile for every individual speaking into it, so that it can switch into the recognition pattern that matches the voice. It would be ideal to build a profile for every television newsreader, presenter, and commentator, but the system would fall over when guests appeared for whom the system did not have a profile. The holy grail of subtitling is to have an engine that recognizes everybody's speech off air and simply translates it into text. But then that would take the fun out of the editing some of our wonderful sports commentary. And what about online? There has been an even bigger increase in the content that's available on the internet. In the past, subtitling has been mainly for television. But now we're starting to see subtitles online through websites such as YouTube, using machine-generated captions. So the text obvious progression is live content streamed online with subtitles. Many broadcasters are already contemplating the idea of online live streamed news, and there's definitely a demand for it, especially as people are accessing the internet on the go. If this is the next step, the industry needs legal regulation for live subtitled content online in the same way as television. Live broadcast content on television continues to grow rapidly. 3D, VOD, IPTV, and mobiles all require rapid advances in technology. With the progression of specifically designed voice recognition packages, the future of live subtitling looks set to be fascinating.